Some of you know that I have my friend Bill Lockwood on every month at the last Tuesday of the month. But because of a couple of statements he made in the last Tuesday, some folks like, I don't agree with Bill. They really want to talk to him about it. And so my friend Bill Lockwood is back. So Bill Lockwood is a radio host, teacher, pastor of the Our Park Church of Christ, and the author of the book Ezekiel, The Watchman of Israel. And Bill will be back the last of this month as well. It's just that I have so many people who responded to his last show that I wanted to have him back to explain some of the things. And Bill, welcome back. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you, Jesse Lee? Good to talk to you.
Yeah, you too, man. Thank you for coming on. I know that you're not normally on twice a month, but thank you for coming.
Oh, absolutely.
The last time you were here, near the end of the show, we talked about this the book called the Talmud, right?
Right.
And compared it with the Old Testament. I remember. Am I right about that?
We did talk about the Talmud, right? And we mentioned the Old Testament and Judaism. That's correct.
Right. And several people responded to that. They disagreed with you. Some agreed, but several disagreed about what you had to say about the Talmud, about Islam, and about Christ. And so I had a young man, I don't know how old you are, but a man called me from New York, I believe. His name is Edward. And Edward has been listening to my show for about 2 years. And he called to explain that what you had said about the Talmud was not true. And that he was born a Jew and had a disagreement about it. So I asked him to come on to discuss with you about it because I don't know anything about the Talmud or all that kind of stuff. And so Edwards is here. Let me bring Edward on. Hey, Edward, you're from Missouri, not New York, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, meet Bill Lockwood. Bill Lockwood, meet Edward.
Hey, Edward, how are you?
How are you? How are you? Good. Nice to meet you, Bill. Nice for the opportunity to speak with you. Hey, Jesse, there's something, a question you asked before that I wanted to, that you were confused about, the Jews being very liberal.
Well, and yeah, but let's get into what Bill is here first, and then we can get into the question you have for me. Bill is here, Edward, so tell Bill what you, and ask what you want to ask of him, and what you disagreed with about concern, what he had to say about the Talmud and the Old Testament and Islam. Go ahead.
Well, it's just a broad, sweeping assertions that he's made just aren't reflected in history or reality. So it's really a broad, you know, a broad spectrum. I guess the first question I would have is what does Bill define as Judaism? How does Bill define Judaism? Is it a people? Is it a culture? Is it a genetic lineage? Is it a religion?
Bill?
Well, you're right. Yeah. Well, first of all, even the rabbis and the Talmud, so forth, Judaism, according to the rabbis, is Talmudism and has really nothing to do with the Old Testament at all. Jacob Neusner wrote about this very boldly and plainly in his book, Jews and Christians, The Myth of a Common Tradition. There are many others also, but Judaism basically is a Talmudism. It goes back to the Talmud and is not really, we're not talking about bloodline Jews. We're talking about Talmudism. So I think it's important also, Edward, that we always differentiate between Jews, the people, and the books that define Judaism. And just as in Islam, not every Muslim lives down to the Quran. So also, Jews do not necessarily live down to the ethics of the Talmud.
I'm going to attempt, Bill, to do a Jesse. In the fact that I don't think you answered my question. What in your definition, what is Judaism?
Talmudism.
And what is Talmudism?
Talmudism?
Is it a religion? Is it a, what is Talmudism to you?
Well, the rabbis themselves tell us what it is. They themselves tell us that it is based upon the Talmud, that Judaism, it comes straight out of it and is defined by it. I suppose you can call it a religion, but that's how the rabbis themselves define it, Edward.
So, Edward, being a Jew, what is it that you disagree with Bill about? That? Bill, is it called Talmud or Talmud?
Well, it's T-A-L-M-U-D.
Short U.
Yeah,
so it's Talmud.
It's what now?
Talmud, like a short U, Talmud.
Talmud, okay. What is it, being a Jew, Edward, you called in that day, what is it that you disagree with Bill about?
Well, all of his assertions. For example, the Talmud is what, from the very beginning, what was considered the oral, meaning the verbal Torah, or the oral Bible. And it is believed and written that that Moses, when he received in writing from God the Torah, which are the five books of Moses, the five books of the Bible, Moses was also given the oral Torah, which was not to be written down, and it was to be passed orally down among the rabbis from the generation. But it is firmly believed the Talmud was originally given by God to Moses orally.
Do you agree with that, Bill?
That's exactly right. That is a fabrication that the Jewish people at the time of Christ even held. As a matter of fact, we find that in Matthew chapter 15, whereby they would actually negate the word of God, what is said in the Ten Commandments, for example, by means of their own, and it was called the tradition of the elders. And the tradition of the elders themselves weighed more importantly than did the actual word of God. And that's exactly right. And they concocted the idea that it went all the way back to an oral tradition that was given to Moses at Mount Sinai at the same time that he gave the written law.
Well, I have to tell you, Bill, you're making assertions, but you're not supporting them. In other words, you say it's a fabrication.
Well,
so where are you getting the idea that this is some concocted thing, using that term?
Well, you know what, Edward? It's not my duty to prove a negative. You're asserting that it came out of came to Moses orally by God. It's up to you to prove that to be the case, and that you cannot do.
It's not a negative. You're making an assertion. All I'm asking you is for your basis for your assertion.
The assertion is that it came directly to Moses from God and was given by oral tradition all the way through the centuries. That's the assertion. That's unprovable, not able to be proved. As a matter of fact, we know that it did not occur simply because that the Talmud and the Mishnah grew through the centuries and was written down finally in the 5th and 6th centuries. And so we have it today in written form, but
the Mishnah was written down in the second century, began being written down in the second century. But your point is valid. But your logical fallacy is just it's irrational. Prove the Bible was given to Moses. Prove the moon isn't. You know, I mean, it's just you're throwing out assertions and then not offering any back basis for it at all, and then you're turning to me or anybody else and saying, "Prove that this is true."
What is my assertion?
That kind of logical.
What's the assertion?
What is my assertion, Edward?
Your assertion is that it's a lie or a concoction that the oral Torah or the oral Bible given to Moses never happened. That's your assertion, is it not?
you're turning logic on its head here. And the idea that the oral law was given to Moses is what you believe to be the case. I deny it. I say that it is not true.
Hold on. Let Bill finish. Go ahead, Bill.
I was going to say, you know what? If I were to assert that the Bible is from God, then I would not turn around and say, well, you prove it's not so, and that's your assertion, it's not the word of God, therefore you prove it. No, it would be up to me to have the laboring oar in my hands and to show it's the word of God, and I can do that. You cannot do that regarding oral tradition.
And Bill, did you say that, and Bill is a Christian, by the way, folks, and did you say that Christianity is the real religion?
Christianity is the religion from God, that's right. As a matter of fact, this is interesting also. Jacob Neusner, who is a Judaic himself, in his book, The Jews and Christians, The Myth of a Common Tradition, points out that if Jesus is the Christ, then indeed the Old Testament has been fulfilled and Judaism is not true, that is, as we know it today. That all of that material from the Old Testament has been fulfilled. And that's exactly what the New Testament teaches.
And how do you respond to that, Edward?
His whole premise is deluded. He's saying that he's suggesting there's proof, yet he hasn't provided any proof on anything that he's asserting on Christianity. And I'm not questioning Christianity. I'm not questioning any of this.
Do you agree or disagree that Christianity is the religion, the primary religion from God?
I'm not here, Jesse, to talk about what I believe.
Well, why are you here?
Because I believe that his assertions are based on misinformation, on a bias that he has, a prejudice that he has, and that he's generating through false information and his own personal, what I would think is convoluted or inverted logic or lack of logic.
Well, where is your proof that Bill is wrong?
Where's my proof that Bill is wrong about which?
Bill, do you understand what's wrong with whatever what?
Well, let's back up for a moment here. How would you establish, Edward, that the Talmud and the Mishnah, the oral laws, were actually given to Moses? How would you establish that that is the case?
It's like any religion. It's like any religion. It's based on faith. You either believe what is touted in writings, or you don't believe it. It's the same thing with Christianity. It's the same thing with Islam. It's the same thing with any religion. Religion is based on one's choice to believe or not believe. Okay. Religion is not an entity that is provable in any rational way whatsoever. And really, all I was hoping to do was, A, point that out, and hopefully with rational minds that will be accepted, and then to correct some other misinformation or add more complete information to the things that you suggested about the Talmud before. That's really I'm interested in doing. But religion is not something that you prove. It's not a mathematical formula. It's based on faith. So if you...
What do you say to that, Bill?
Say again.
What do you say to that?
Well, I appreciate him confessing out loud and openly that there is no establishing that the oral tradition was given to Moses. It's something that he accepts on the basis of faith only, and that is without any substance, without any historical evidence, period. That's what they believe. That has no proof whatsoever. When we come to the Bible, that is completely different. The New Testament, it is completely different. These things were established historically. I do not accept them simply because I wish to believe them to be the case. The New Testament itself teaches that faith is connected with evidence, and we have historical evidence that Jesus lived, that he died, that he resurrected from the grave. This is historical material.
Edward, do you believe that Islam is a religion?
Islam is a religion, yes. I would definitely agree with that.
Bill, did you say that Islam is not a religion?
No, I didn't. I didn't say that Islam was not a religion.
Oh, okay.
If I did, I misspoke.
No, I don't remember. I don't remember if you said it or not. I just asked. Yeah. But you did say that Islam doesn't have a god or something like that, right?
Well, no. Allah was a believed to be a. He was, as a matter of fact, one of the many gods in Arabia prior to the coming of Muhammad. That's established. By the way, and this is something that might be interesting to Edward, it's established historically. That's not simply what I believe to be the case, that we can establish that with historical documentation that people believe in many gods in Arabia prior to the time of Muhammad, and one of them was named Allah. And that's what how Muhammad, of course, now he got rid of the rest of the gods, and he settled on Allah alone. But that's how Muhammad began his religious concepts.
Do you disagree with that, Edward?
The fact that Muhammad existed, I have no dispute with whatsoever. I would ask one question, I guess I would ask Bill, was Muhammad the chosen prophet of God? Does Bill believe that Muhammad was, as Islam dictates, the foremost prophet from God?
Do you believe that, Edward?
It's not, again, I'm not here to talk about or to offer my
I don't really know what Edward wants, really. I thought he had called me up. He had some disagreement.
I'm happy to answer that. Absolutely not. Muhammad was a false prophet. He was not a prophet at all. He claimed himself that he did no miracle to establish what he had to say. All of his material can be traced back to other materials. No, he was not a prophet of God at all. You know, when you push the religion...
Wait a minute. Hold on, Bill. Can you prove that he was not a prophet?
There you go again. Can you prove a negative?
No, sir. I'm being fair. Sir, I am being fair. You asked me to prove something.
No,
you asked me to pursue something that I was suggesting
You're standing on your head, Edward.
Hold on, Edward. Go ahead, Bill.
I'm just going to say, Edward, you're standing on your head looking at this. It would be up to the Muslims to prove that Muhammad actually received a revelation from God. I can show, however, that his materials actually originated earlier than himself. But it's not up to me to prove that he was not. It would be up to a Muslim to prove that he is. Otherwise, you're throwing a negative on me. But I'm happy to say, yes, we can show that he was not. We can show that to be the case.
So, Bill, is this Allah guy you guys are talking about, is that the same Allahu Akbar guy?
No, Allah is the God of the Muslims.
So when the Muslims are ready to blow you up and they cry Allahu Akbar, are they talking about that guy?
That's right, yeah.
Amazing. That ain't no God.
Mm-hmm, that's right. That's exactly the same.
I'm sorry?
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Edward, is there anything else you disagree with Bill about that you wanted to ask him about? We ran out of time, and so far you haven't done very well.
Well, I disagree with you. I believe the tenet of religion is faith, Jesse, and to ask any religion to prove to another religion.
Is there anything else that you disagree with Bill about? Any other question for him or something you disagree with?
Jesse, his information is incorrect. I'm sorry I wasn't as helpful as you were hoping me to be. The man is twisting a bunch of information about Jews because he clearly has a disdain for Jews, maybe has a disdain for anybody that doesn't agree with him or doesn't believe what he believes. And I was hoping for the opportunity to demonstrate this. I think I did that to some folks. I understand he's your friend, but...
But that has nothing to do
with it. But, Bill, Edward, I know that you didn't like the fact that... you didn't like Bill saying that the Talmud was blasphemy against Jesus or something like that, right?
No, I was making the point that it is an unjust principle to call somebody an infidel, which is exactly what the Muslims do. They say anybody who doesn't believe what I believe is an infidel, and that Bill was doing exactly the same thing that the Muslims do in that regard. If you don't believe what Bill believes, you're an infidel. But the measure of being an infidel is if I believe in something and then I go against the thing I believe in. That's the idea of an infidel, to apply that principle to people who don't believe what you do is the seeds of prejudice and discrimination and hate and disdain. That was the point I was making on that regard.
How do you respond to that, Bill?
You know what? I'm glad we finally get into the Talmud. Number one, I never called Jews infidels. I did not use that term. I referred to the fact that the Talmud has blasphemous statements regarding Jesus Christ. It tells us that he was actually born an illegitimate son, that his father was Pandera, a Roman soldier, and that Mary was a sexually promiscuous woman. It tells us that he learned magic in Egypt and that he did practice sorcery. It tells us that he is in hell forever. I said those comments are blasphemous. Now, I want Edward to note this. It has nothing to do with what I think about Jews or Jewish people, and he has a hard time differentiating Talmudism from the people themselves, and there is a major distinction to be made. It's the same thing when I go to the Quran. Muslims do not necessarily believe all of this in the Quran. I'm not charging all Muslims with what the Quran actually teaches, but that's what the Quran teaches. This is what the Talmud teaches regarding Jesus Christ.
That's not my point, Bill. My point is you're applying the concept of blasphemy to any individual who doesn't believe what you believe, and I'm saying that's a misapplication of the concept or the idea of blasphemy. All right?
Well, I think it is blasphemous to say that God wears phylacteries, which the Talmud teaches, that God offers a sacrifice for his own mistakes, which the Talmud teaches. I believe that's blasphemous. That's what I'm using as blasphemy. It's a derogatory statement regarding deity. It's not simply disagreeing with me. It's derogatory statements regarding the Messiah, telling us that he's boiling in hot excrement forever and ever. That's Talmudic statements, and those are not. That's not me.
Hold on, Edward. Hold on, Bill. Let me take a quick break. Hold on, Edward. Hold on, Bill. We'll take a quick break and come back to this. Amazing. I want to get back to Bill Lockwood. And Bill is a radio host, teacher, pastor of the Our Park Church of Christ, and the author of the book Ezekiel, the Watchman of Israel. One of the smartest white men on this side of heaven, sent by God. And Bill is on with me every last Tuesday of every month. And he was here last month, and he talked about some things that a bunch of people disagree with. I don't understand. So I have Bill back to answer the questions as the people were questioning Bill. He is my friend, and I know his family, good folks, really good folks. And Edward is a caller from Missouri, a Jewish guy. Bill is a Christian. Edward is a Jew. And he disagreed with Bill. So I was hoping to give Edward a chance to disagree with Bill so that Bill can respond to it. Bill, tell the folks how to get your show and read your book and all that good stuff.
Well, my show is American Liberty with Bill Lockwood, and it airs out of Wichita Falls on News Talk 1290 AM dial on Saturdays at 11 o'clock. And it's also in Lubbock and Abilene, Lubbock at 790 AM on Sunday afternoon at 5, and in Abilene at the same time at News Talk 1440. Then the website's the same, AmericanLibertyWithBillLockwood.com. So now is Edward gone or is he?
No, he's still here. I'm going to bring him in.
Okay. All right.
Put me back on, Joe. Okay. And Edward is still here, and Edward is a non-practicing Jew. What does that mean, Edward, to be a non? How can you be a Jew and don't practice being a Jew if that's what you are?
Well, that goes back to the question that I asked, that I posed to him before. Judaism is a religion, and any religion is practiced. I think we all would agree on that, that you practice the tenets of a religion. So I don't practice the religion. I'm 54, so I don't practice the religion. I haven't for a little while.
And so, but you still are a Jew, but you just don't participate in the religion. Am I right about that?
Well, that's one thing I was.
Am I right about that? Am I right about that part?
Well, it's. I was born what common people would think you're born. I was born a Jew. But that's a genetic thing that has nothing to do with not really anything much to do with the religion per se, the practicing of the religion. You do not have to be born a Jew to be a Jew. One can convert to be a Jew, as a matter of fact.
So if you convert to be a Jew, does that mean you're just you're part of their religion, but as a human being, you're not a real Jew, right? You're still a whatever.
No. No, actually, it's written in the Jewish laws that it is a sin to mention to a converted Jew to bring up the topic he's converted. That is a sin. So when a Jew is converted or a person converts into Judaism, then they are as much a Jew as anybody else. And it is, again, it's a sin for already existing Jews practicing to even bring that topic up.
Amazing. I don't understand the Jew thing. I love Israel. I love the Jews because Christianity came from that. But I don't understand all this other stuff. What other questions do you have for Bill Edward?
Well, I didn't have any questions. Remember, I mean, if Bill touts himself as an expert on Judaism, I think that's a bit silly. I think one should go to sources, the actual people who believe in it, if you want to learn about it. So, I was here to talk to Bill to clear up some things that he presented before last week that were simply inaccurate or were left out.
Like what? Other than the Talmud, what else?
He mentioned conservative Jews not adhering to the Talmud, which is categorically incorrect. The conservative level of Judaism absolutely refers quite heavily to the Talmud. So that's a complete piece of misinformation that he touted last week.
And that, how would you say to that, Bill?
Well, first of all, I don't recall him saying that they don't adhere to the Talmud. I mean, I believe Judaism is Talmudism. But let me go to something here real quickly. He says that I tout myself as an expert. I do not. And he wished that I would go to the authors. You know what? I have a list of authors from whom I have learned, all of them Jews, who have taught me this through their writings on the Talmud. Let me just mention these. There's a professor, Robert Goldberg, in his Back to the Sources, reading the classic Jewish text. How about the Kabbalah Lubavitch movement in Judaism today, which tells us exactly what I have said today, right here, that the Talmud teaches. He and his disciples practice sorcery and black magic. He led the Jews into idolatry, were sponsored by foreign Gentile powers for the purpose of subverting the Jewish worship. That's in Sanhedrin 43. That Jesus was sexually immoral. He worshiped statues of stone. A brick is mentioned, was cut off from the Jewish people for his wickedness, refused to repent. That's in Sanhedrin 107 and Sota 47. He learned witchcraft in Egypt. Shabbos 104. That's from the Chabad Lubavitch website. This is not me saying I'm an expert in Judaism. Also learned from Peter Schaefer, who is a Princeton University Jew, and his book, Jesus and the Talmud, is absolutely second to none in this whole thing. And he shows exactly what's happened, that not only is this what the Talmud teaches regarding Christ, but that Jewish censors have come along through the years for Gentile eyes and changed the name Jesus into other names such as Balaam or Sinners of Israel. And they've changed that up so that we might be more palatable to us. Not only so, but Halakha.com website has all on it and the footnotes of it. Here's something else. Celsus in the second century wrote an anti-Christian screed. He was a pagan, and he was answered by Origen, a Christian, in the next century. That would be the beginning of the fourth century. In Celsus's material, he said that the Jews taught him that Jesus was the son of a Roman soldier by the name of Panthera or Pandera, P-A-N-D-E-R-A. And this is what Origen answers. We know it from Origen's material, which, of course, extant to us today. This is not something that I have concocted. It's not something that I'm coming up with because I dislike Jews, anything like that, nor is it something that I claim to be an expert on. The Jewish Encyclopedia has all of this material within it. It's simply a matter of whether people are willing to read and understand what the texts actually are saying.
Edward?
Bill, you're applying a principle of belief that Jesus was a Messiah to a group of individuals or a group that doesn't share that view. Everything what you said was for Jews or the group of Jews who practice Judaism, who do not believe that Jesus was a Messiah. So you're taking it personally, but these things are not for you. They're not for non-Jews. So if it was for non-Jews, I could see why you'd be offended by it. But this is the position held by by the Jews about Jesus. It's not for you. It's what they believe. It's what they believe. They don't require you to agree. It's not there to offend you or to assault you. So you're applying, you're because you apply your beliefs and other people have to believe it, you are projecting that Jews want you to believe what they believe, and they don't care. So there's zero reason for you to pay any attention to what the Jews believe. You should believe what you believe without having to denigrate a group who does not share your beliefs at all.
Well, you know what, Edward, I do appreciate you coming on here, and especially for that last statement. You know what? So you agree that's what the Talmud does indeed teach regarding Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what I've said. I consider that to be blasphemous material. You know, it's one thing, Edward, to reject Christ and say, you know, I don't believe he's the Messiah. I understand that. I don't get angry, and I don't get Jew-hating or anything like that, or anybody hateful. But it's another thing to go along and say he's boiling in hot excrement with Titus, who destroyed Israel and Jerusalem in 70 AD, and who they say is boiling in hot semen in hell forever. That's a little different. Just the same as to say that Jesus was sexually promiscuous, that he learned magic in Egypt, that his mother was sexually promiscuous, that she had sexual intercourse with a Roman soldier named Pandera. That's a little different, wouldn't you say?
That works.
It's not for you, Bill. That's what I'm trying to say. You're offended by something that you're not the audience of. So it makes no sense. Whatever they say, whatever people say about a different group, that there's nothing to be offended by it. They don't share your belief. They believe that Jesus, at the time of Jesus Christ, there was the chief rabbi Newt, which still exists, has always existed and still exists to this day, and Jesus was viewed as a massive threat to their power structure. And so it's logical to conclude if you're deemed somebody as a threat, an existential threat, that you're going to have a negative response to that individual. I'm not saying right or wrong or what I agree with, but that's human nature. And then for you to then, it makes no sense for you to be offended by it. This is that perspective based on the belief of somebody that made claims that the Jewish doctrine of the time did not adhere to or believe or agree with in any way. It makes perfect sense. Jesse used the term last week, fake news. It was kind of cute. To the Jews, it was a threatening fake news. I'm not saying that they were right or wrong at that time, but that's their perspective.
Right.
You are free to believe what you want to believe, but to apply the concept of blasphemy to a group that doesn't believe what you believe in the first place is ludicrous. It's no different than what the Muslims do. The grandson of Van Gogh, whose brains were on the street of Denmark, because he drew a cartoon of Muhammad, which was considered blasphemy. But guess what? Van Gogh was not a Muslim, so the whole concept of blasphemy didn't apply to Van Gogh, and it doesn't apply here.
Bill?
Well, you know what? When the word blasphemy simply means to denigrate deity, and that's the Talmud does that. It tells us that even God has a sacrifice offered for himself. That's how I have the idea of blasphemy. I'm not offended because they have not accepted Christ. That's not the offensive portion of it. But certainly, I do want everybody to hear.
Edward,
and I appreciate Edward's comment on this. That is, he is confessing that is exactly what the Talmud says, and all the things that I have learned from the Talmud, I've learned from different Jewish authors who tell me that's what the Talmud actually teaches regarding Christ. But it is so offensive, that is the type of material that's in there, the it's kind of R-rated material. It's so offensive that that's why Jewish censors have come along and changed some of the wording of it. And this is not goyim censors coming along and being offended. These are actually Jewish censors coming along and changing names in the Talmud in order for goyim eyes. That's all I'm saying. It's a fact.
I was told, I not heard it myself, but there's a rabbi who claimed that the Talmud wasn't talking about Jesus, but was talking about someone else. Is that part of the cover-up that you're talking about, Bill?
That's exactly correct.
Hold on a minute, then I'll come right to you. Go ahead, Bill.
Well, okay, yeah, I'll tell you what. For one thing, Johann Meyer was a writer in the 1970s, and he did, but this, as well as a Gill student, who's a rabbi today, or a Judaic, and he's on the internet, but there's a massive effort to cover this up and disinformation and misdirection for Goyim. And this is part of the error of it and the sin of it, and that is this misdirection. All you have to do is read books such as Peter Schaeffer's Jesus in the Talmud, the Princeton University scholar. He shows what all of the manuscripts of the Talmud actually do say and where the censors have changed it. Michael Hoffman in Judaism's Strange Gods has documented it heavily, as well as in his book Judaism Discovered. Others such as, you know, there are other writers such as Klinghoffer, whose father was a rabbi. He says exactly these things, what I'm saying, are correct. And that what's happening is censors have tried to misdirect the attention of the Goyim people so that they don't think that this has these ugly things about Christ. But I'm not offended that people don't accept Christ. And I want him to understand that. That Edward does not accept him. But what is offensive is the type of material that's in there. And I think people understand that to be the case.
No.
Edward,
no,
go ahead.
You're historically incorrect. The Jewish authority, the chief rabbi knew throughout history, doesn't really care what you call Goyim or Gentiles believe or don't believe about Jews. Historically, Jews have been persecuted and essentially destroyed in large mass all throughout history. So if there's any truth to what you're saying, and let's say there is for the sake of discussion, it has nothing to do with the Jews are worried about offending. The Jews are worried about getting themselves hung or burned in ovens or tortured like in the Inquisition. They're just trying to survive. But I can assure you, Bill, the Jewish authorities, like in Israel, the Rabbanu, they don't, if life and death wasn't at risk here, and prior to the serious programs that started in the Middle Ages, Jews didn't care. It's only when it became okay to kill Jews in mass is when they started having concerns about it. So you put that historical context in, it makes a lot more sense why translations may or may not be watered down in order to protect your life.
Bill?
Yeah. You know what? I'm going to agree with Edward right here. I absolutely understand that. I understand that's the case. I believe that Jews have been persecuted throughout history. I believe he's exactly right about that. I think that that is partially the reason that they have censored it. I don't believe that explains all of it. But nevertheless, I agree with that. I also want to point out, just in addition to that, that Christians have been persecuted as well. I don't believe in any kind of physical harm to anybody for what they believe, or even what if they put ugly things about Christ or saying ugly things. I don't believe people ought to be persecuted physically for anything at all, and I don't believe that. But I just simply am pointing out what the texts actually say. But I do appreciate what Edward have to say there, and I agree in large measure with what he just said.
So I have a couple questions from the listening audience here. And then we got to wind it down. I'll let you guys have your closing statements. So I asked Edward first and then Bill. This is from one of the listeners. They want to know, are Jews allowed to lie to Christians? Edward?
I think he's referring to the Muslim doctrine that says it's okay in the Quran or the other books to do that. Jews don't address this issue that I've ever been exposed to in my entire life. It's a non-issue.
So are Jews allowed to lie to Christians?
There's nothing about it. I guess the answer is they could lie or not lie. It's no different than you. Are you allowed to lie or not lie?
So the answer is no. They can lie if they want, or they can tell the truth.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing in Jewish doctrine that indicates anything about that.
And what do you say to that question, Bill? Are Jews allowed to lie to Christians?
Yes, they are. And I'll give the example here. And this is from the Talmud itself with Rabbi Akiva, who was a second century rabbi. And he himself tells about questioning individuals and saying things, but saying different than what he thinks in his heart in order to get them to confess something. And that kind of statement is made. It teaches situation ethics. Not only so, but in the Jewish Encyclopedia, and I'm not saying that Edward believes this necessarily or has even practiced this, but I am saying that the Jewish Encyclopedia, and I think it's Volume 6, talks about the Kol Nidre vow, which actually allows Jews to say that all of the vows that they're going to take this coming year is null and void if they're made with Gentile people, and allows them to lie. That's the Kol Nidre vow, and it's an interesting thing, but that's in the Jewish Encyclopedia.
Is that true, Edward?
I don't know anything about the Jewish Encyclopedia, but it is taught in the Talmud that you have to honor your agreement, okay? So that is in the Jewish, the religious Jewish doctrine.
Bill, so, the second question. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Finish up, Edward.
I just said I don't know about the other book, the Encyclopedia. But
okay.
Anyway.
Yes, Bill.
I was going to say in the Talmud itself tells us the Jews may lie to non-Jews. That's the Babylonian Talmud, and that's Baba Kama, 113 and the letter A. There are a lot of things like that, but that is in the Talmud, and that's. But I'm not necessarily saying that Edward's familiar with it, or Edward practices any of these things. But I'm just simply saying that's what the Talmud teaches, not simply the Jewish Encyclopedia. The Kol Nidre vows is one of the things that they practice, or some of them do.
You're allowed to lie to survive is what you're referring to. Like during the Inquisition, it was not considered a sin to lie to save your life. That's what you're twisting.
Oh, so you are allowed to lie.
To save your life. Do you understand the difference?
Yes, do you understand what situation ethics are?
Of course I do. But I'm saying you're leaving out the context. That's all I'm pointing out.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. That's situation ethics. That's what it is.
And give me a
nothing
short.
Nothing different than Joseph Fletcher. No different than Joseph Fletcher.
A short answer to this question. Is it true that Armenian was genocide, was a Christian genocide? I think that's it. Yeah. Is it true that Armenian genocide was a Christian genocide, Bill?
I don't understand the Median genocide. What are you talking about?
Remember the Armenian people?
Armenian.
Okay.
Armenian people said that they were genocide and that they were Christians. Is that true? Did that happen?
I don't know about the Armenians. What time frame are we talking about? Very recently?
I have no idea.
Under the Ottoman Empire. Under the Ottoman Empire, I think he's referring.
Well, I'll say this, that there have been terrible persecutions throughout the centuries by Roman Catholics, and that's one reason I oppose Catholicism as well. Catholicism is not New Testament Christianity. It does not represent the religion of Jesus Christ. It is an apostasy, as pointed out in the New Testament. But Catholicism, if we're going to equate it with Christianity, then we are on wrong ground to begin with. That was Catholic material. That's Catholic persecution.
Okay.
And they themselves, Catholics, persecuted throughout centuries. That is exactly right.
Well, I've been told that the Armenian genocide was by Muslim Turks. So that happened 100
Correct.
Years ago.
Okay.
Edward, closing remark. We have 2 minutes left. Closing remarks.
Well, my closing remark would just be to suggest that Bill gives serious, serious long-term contemplation to the principles that he's applying. The idea of applying your beliefs to other people and then incorporating the idea of blasphemy is a very dangerous thing to do. People will, that's a false principle to apply, and it's got historical devastating consequences. You should be free to believe whatever you believe the truth is, but you should allow the same freedom without applying your standards and your beliefs onto other people. And I think that's where the problem really lies and becomes dangerous.
Closing remark, Bill.
You know what? I agree 100% with what he just said. We ought to have the freedom to believe. I don't deny him the freedom to believe it. At the same time, I have the freedom to say this is what they believe without being called some name or about being called a Jew hater. I'm simply saying this is what the Talmud teaches. That's exactly right. And I base it on freedom. It's interesting that when the communists took Soviet Union, the first thing they passed was laws against anti-Semitism. They didn't want any discussion. And I appreciate Edward coming on and having an open discussion on these particular terms. So at any rate, thank you for having us today, Jesse.
Yeah, that was very, mamma mia, hola, interesting. Very, very interesting. And I appreciate you guys, both of you, for coming on and talking about it. Bill, we'll see you again on the end of the month, if the Lord is willing and the creek don't rise.
Right. Thank you so much, Jesse Lee.
All right.
Looking forward to it.
All right. Thank you, Bill. And thank you, Edward. I appreciate you calling in about this and your willingness to talk to Bill about it. Thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
All right. You're welcome. All right, folks. It's amazing. Amazing. And don't forget to like, follow, tweet, subscribe, and share the Jesse Lee Peterson Radio Show, folks. We really appreciate it. We are at war. It is a spiritual battle for the soul of America. And it's going to take all of us to do it.